church. We have a guest who's leading us in praise and worship, Christian Goldsmith. Can we thank God for him for the weekend?
Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. And we're going to sing this morning a couple songs. We're going to open up with a song about the glory of God and the greatness of our God. So join together with us as we sing. Put your hands together. this morning we're going to sing a song that most of you will probably know. It's O Come to the Altar. And this morning I just want to encourage you that whatever you've brought in here, maybe it's fear, maybe it's the unknown, maybe it's just something going on in your life that you just don't understand. Jesus is here to meet you, and he will meet you where you are if you just surrender and you open your heart. And that's one of the beautiful things about the posture of worship, is that when we just expose our hearts to him, he takes care of the rest. So just allow him to come and minister to you right now as we sing this song.
Jesus is calling. cross as you wait for the crown. Tell the world of the treasure you found.
Another. Welcome to CRC.
Church this week, and on behalf of our pastor, welcome. If you're new to Christ the Rock, make sure to fill out our Connect card found in your bulletin and drop it off at the Welcome Center. Stay connected with us by downloading our official CRCC app on iOS or Android. It's the best way to keep up with sermons, events, and even mobile giving.
Are you interested in being a member here at Christ the Rock? Our next Connect Growth Track starts June 3rd at noon. Visit our website or the lobby for more information.
Shalom, parents. We invite you to sign up your little ones for a summer camp experience that will take your children on an adventure through the Holy Land. We will be taking a step back in time and following Jesus from the manger to the crown. The journey begins June 18th through the 22nd from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. for a cost of just $45. You can sign up today online at crcconline.org, on the CRCC Online app, or in the lobby. CRCC members, if you're interested in a one-time serving opportunity, we have opened opportunities to serve for this year's KOR Vacation Bible Camp. You can sign up in the lobby today.
Waking up knowing there's a reason. All my dreams come alive. Life is for living with you. I've made my decision. See the sun now bursting through the clouds, black and white, turn to color all around. All is new in the Savior I have found. This is living now.
May 19th and May 20th to kick off this year's summer camp, Chosen. On May 19th, we'll be having a Color Wars field day. Register for $5. Lunch is included. Then, on May 20th, come to the service you attend wearing your team colors. Lastly, don't forget to stop by our table outside of the sanctuary for some delicious holy carbs.
That's all for this week. Let's continue to lead people to an ever-growing personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
So can I sleep with you? And she said yes. We were running in the dark. I had my boots on, and I was running towards the hole. and I couldn't see because it was nighttime, and I fell into the hole. My knee was like that, and my leg was like that, so I twisted this ankle. So, and then my mom sat me on the chair. She said, let me get you ice. And the third day I twisted my ankle, before we went to the party, my mom, she put on TV, and she laid me down in the bed. She stacked two pillows, and she made me put my foot on there, and she prayed with me. She said good night, and I hope you feel better.
So look at the camera and say, we love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Wait, what?
And that's the end. As soon as you
what
do
did
that,
you say? We love you, Mom. We love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
I'm Francesca, this is Lindsay, this is Sigourney, oldest, youngest, and the middle. So in what ways did you feel like mommy influenced you?
I feel like she influenced me a lot with like my own relationship that I have with God. I guess you can see like when I was younger, I was kind of like shy-ish and I didn't really want to like come to church, but like stay away, I guess. So today now I'm really blessed that I can come here and like talk to other people and we have the same issues and really just be positive around each other and like seek God. So I'm really happy that she did that for me and that she brought me here.
In what ways did mommy influence you?
Mommy influenced me through education and work. She would always tell me to put education before work. As she got sick, I wanted to put work before education. I wanted to support her more, make money more, you know, just invest in that time. But as I'm older and her influence is still alive, I put education before work and I'm able to balance out both. So she really influenced me through both education and work. How about you? How did she influence you?
Mommy was just such a fearless woman, you know, she was so hardworking, so independent. I aspire to be like that one day. And when she got sick, I just, you know, I thought she'd stop, I thought she'd slow down, but she never did. She just kept going, and that was so admiring, you know. I aspire to be like her one day. She taught me to be a strong woman and to just never, you know, stop doing what you're doing just because of something like that. And a mom, I feel like, is always gonna be there for you for the rest of your life. They're always gonna prepare you for hard times. But preparing you to lose a mom is like not something that they think about, and it's not something that we thought about, but she definitely prepared us for that. I love her for that. Love you, Mommy.
Happy Mother's Day.
Well, good morning and happy Mother's Day. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Ushers, you can let the people in as we're preparing for the message. You can go ahead and let them in. So we greet each of you today, and Mother's happy, happy, happy Mother's Day. Just a couple of things to be reminded to you. First of all, there's a booth, a photo booth out there. If you have your cell phone, you can take a picture. We have a photographer out there. Just take some pictures of moms and make sure you enjoy that. That's out there for all of our moms. Also, I want to thank you for supporting our camp initiative, summer camp. Many of you are stopping by to get some holy carbs, and I thank you for supporting the bake sale out there. And then some of you have committed to sponsoring a kid, and this is a kid for camp. And so you're joining me and many others out there. Thank you so much for those. And would you consider to make sure that every child who wants to go to camp will be able to go to camp, because we're making an investment in their future. And then, of course, if you need some last minute gift items, they're out there in our media center. A lot of things you can pick up from mom today on this glorious Mother's Day. We are in a clothes drive for Honduras. In July, a group of us are going to Honduras. It is the Rotan Alive 2018 missions trip. And so we're asking you to bring some gently used clothes. Tell your neighbor, gently used. Go ahead and tell them. Yes, yes, yes. If it has holes in it, you can keep it and just throw it away. We want something that has been gently used, and it's going to go really, really far. I had the great honor of being a part last year in the clothes distribution, and it was just wonderful. The people come in, and they were so appreciative for the sacrifices that's made, not only to our church and many other churches. And so the bins are out there in the lobby area. Bring your gently used items, and they're going to go to a great cause. And then on this Saturday, May 19th, right here in the main sanctuary, we're going to get more information about our trip to Israel. And so right here, 10 o'clock in the main sanctuary, Dr. Gage, myself, and the travel agent will be here. We're going to lay out the itinerary, and you can ask questions about the hotel, about the travel. Even if you're not going, it'd be great for you to come and just ask your questions, because these people can definitely give you all the information you want to know about planning a trip to Israel. Okay, let's pray. Father, I thank you today. As we focus on this glorious moment, this glorious celebration called Mother's Day, we thank you for our moms. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the mothers present here and the mothers that have gone on before. Lord, today, we thank you that Jesus had a mother and Jesus cared for his mother. Even at the height of his suffering, he says, John, take care of my mother. Lord, thank you so much for moms. As we celebrate in our church, Lord, and many other churches on this blessed Lord Day, we pray for every church and every pastor, every congregation, Lord. Thank you today that the kingdom of God is large. And we pray for our fellow brothers and sisters, followers of Christ. And now, Lord, as we gathered here on these grounds called Christ the Rock Community Church, it is your church. And may no flesh get glory in the presence of our God. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. I want you to turn your Bibles finally to Joshua chapter 2. And I'll be honest with you, as I was preparing the message and going into the book of Joshua, I forgot that Mother's Day was right around the corner when I announced that we were going into it right after Easter. And as I was coming upon this beautiful day that we celebrate mothers, I was asking the Lord, what should be the message of this Mother's Day? And when I came to Joshua chapter 2, I'll be honest with you, I didn't see Rahab being an example of a godly mother. Of course, you know, there's only one name mentioned in Joshua chapter 2, and that's the name Rahab. And you know that Rahab is listed, we'll see in the scripture, and I want to remind you, as a prostitute. And not necessarily that occupation is something that we're going to lift up, but I want you to see transformation. I want you to see the godly attributes of a godly mother that we're going to see in the example of Rahab. And I'm going to show you some things in the New Testament as it relates to Rahab, and then we'll go to chapter number 3 next week. Okay, that's our plan. Let's get to Joshua chapter 2, starting at verse number 1. Hear the word of the Lord. Then Joshua secretly sent out 2 spies from the Israelite camp at Acacia Grove. He instructed them, scout out the land on the other side of the Jordan River, especially around Jericho. So the 2 men set out and came to the house of the prostitute named Rahab and stayed there that night. But someone told the king of Jericho, some Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land. So the king of Jericho sent orders to Rahab, bring out the men who have come into your house, for they have come here to spy out the whole land. Rahab had hidden the 2 men, but she replied, yes, the men were here earlier, but I didn't know where they were from. They left the town at dusk as the gates were about to close. I don't know where they went. If you hurry, you probably can catch up with them. Verse 6, actually, she had taken them up to the roof and hidden them beneath bundles of flax she had laid out. Verse 7, so the king's men went looking for the spies along the road leading to the shallow crossings of the Jordan River. And as soon as the king's men left, the gate of Jericho was shut. Before the spies went to sleep that night, Rahab went up on the roof to talk to them. She says, I know the Lord has given you this land, she told them. We're all afraid of you. Everyone in the land is living in terror, for we have heard how the Lord made a dry path for you through the Red Sea when you left Egypt. And we know that what you did to Sihon and Og, the 2 Amorite kings east of the Jordan River, whose people you completely destroyed. No wonder our hearts have melted in fear. No one has the courage to fight after hearing such things. For the Lord your God is the God supreme of the heavens above and the earth below. For the Lord your God is the supreme God of the heavens above and the earth below. Now swear to me by the Lord that you will be kind to me and my family since I've helped you. Give me the guarantee that when Jericho is conquered, you will let me live along with my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and their families. Let's stop there. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy word. This is a very interesting story, as we talked about already, but I wanted to show you some attributes. First of all, we see a mother's instinct. A mother's instinct. Now, as Rahab is talking to these spies, she instinctively says something that I want us to see in verse number 12. Although the Bible clearly says that she was a prostitute, and I think that is given there to help us to understand her past, but I want you to see that there has been a transformation. Obviously, Rahab has had rehab because Rahab is not thinking of herself. She's thinking of her people. She's instinctively, maternally aware that the cause is bigger than herself. God designed the heart of the mother to be a reflection of his own heart, in that she was caring not only for herself, but she was having a cry out for a portion of her people to be saved. Isaiah 66 and verse 13, God likens himself to a mother's comfort. He says, as a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. See, God instinctively says, now, as you understand the comfort of a mom, it helps you get a glimpse of the comfort that I give you, God says to us. There's something about a woman's instinctive maternal care for a child, whether it's her natural born child or someone adopted or someone she's become a mother figure to. You know, we all know this, that if you bother with the cubs, that the mother bear is going to have a problem with you, right? Because there's this thing, this fierce care, this fierce protection that God has innately given to every woman, every mother in particular. And this is what we're seeing with Rahab. Rahab is saying, save a portion of my people. Rahab is not only interceding for herself, but watch this. She has three generations in mind. She's talking about her mother and father. That's one generation. She's talking about herself and her siblings, brothers and sisters. And she's talking about their families. So Rahab now is interceding on behalf of three generations instinctively. Even it put her at great risk. Even without them asking her, she instinctively said, I need to prepare for these people. See, what Rahab understood was they were going to conquer the city. It was going to happen. That there was nothing she could do to stop this. She saw that the providential hand of God was upon these people and they were coming in. She says, everybody's terrified because we know you're coming and we know you're going to utterly destroy the whole area. But I want you to be kind to me. That word kind is the word hesed. And watch this, verse number 12. Swear to me by the Lord. See, this wasn't them swearing to her on their name, but she said, by the name of the Lord, that you will be hesed. You will be kind. This is a grace. This is something that really has no definition. It's so vast. It's so complete. She says, I want you to be kind to me and swear to me by the power and the authority and in the name of the Lord that you're going to be kind to me. See, she realized she couldn't stop the inevitability of them coming in to conquer. And mothers, today there's some things you just can't stop. There's a cruel world. There are wicked people out there. And I know you wish you could cocoon your child and keep them in a bubble and they never go out, but sooner or later, they got to go out. And you can't stop that. That's called natural process of growth, maturing. I love to talk to dads and let me just digress a minute. I love to talk to dads and when their young girls are growing up and they begin to see them forming and see them maturing and they have this look in their eye, oh my God, one day she's going to bring a boy home. And I wish I could just keep her home and never let her go. But one day she's going to bring a boy like your son. One day your son's going to bring a young girl home. And as much as you want to protect them, but here's the thing. What you should know is some things you can't do. But what you can do is ask God to keep them, church. Yeah. That God would be kind to them. That the grace of God would overshadow them. This is a mother's instinct to care. Secondly, we see a mother's influence. A mother's influence. Now, because of this conversation that Rahab has with these spies, and these spies tell her, leave this cord outside your window. And when we come, because we're coming, and when we conquer, because we're going to conquer, we're going to save everything that's in the household. And her influence was so strong until she was able to influence these three generations to come into her household. She had a conviction. Her conviction was, this is the one true living God. He is the God, supreme God of the heavens above and on the earth below. She was convicted that he, in fact, was the only true God. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 31, I want to remind you that by faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient. Not only was she not killed, her parents were not killed, her siblings and all their families were not killed. But it was attributed to her because of her great influence. Rahab stands out as the most significant Canaanite, as she's accredited with single-handedly saving a portion of her family. Three generations, her influence. The people were afraid. And let's go fast forward. I want to show you how strong this commitment was. Go to Joshua chapter 6. Let's see how this happened. Now, I can give you an overview. This is probably the most dynamic story in the whole book. Now, we'll talk about some wars and some fights. We'll get to chapter 3 next week. And we'll talk about some things, how they divided the land. But the most redemptive story is in Joshua chapter 2. But let's see how it ends. Go to Joshua chapter 6. Let's see the fight. Let's see how it plays out. And in Joshua chapter 6, verse number 22, the Bible says this: Joshua said to the two men who had scattered the land, "Go to the prostitute's house and bring the woman out of there and all those who are with her, just as you promised her." And so the young men who had scattered went in and brought out Rahab and her father, her mother, her brothers, and all who belonged to her. They brought out her whole family and settled them outside the camp of Israel. Can you imagine how Rahab felt? Can you imagine how the people in the house, how she had to influence them to say, "Listen, I've made a covenant. I've made a covenant with these men, and they swore to me by their God that when they come to conquer the city," because everybody knows they're coming. If you're in the house, there we're going to be safe. And now here comes the scouts to say, "Hey, come on, it's time." And they left. And watch this, verse number 24. And they burned up the whole city, everything in it. But they put the silver and the gold and the articles of bronze and iron and the treasure in the Lord's house. However, Joshua spared Rahab the prostitute, her father's household, and all who belonged to her, because she hid the men Joshua had sent to spy on Jericho. And she lives in Israel. How long, church? Oh, don't miss this. She lives in Israel to this day. What David's talking about? To this day. If you read the Bible next month, to that day, to this day, that's written specifically to let you know that this is a perpetual promise, that it wasn't just over in the Old Testament, but to this day, Rahab, which is a remnant, lives in Israel today. My responsibility is to show you that. Let me read this quote right here. Reverend Terry Laughlin says this: "The Christian mother will train and equip and care for herself in a way that benefits the whole family. The mother of godly influence works to keep herself healthy, alert, and well-equipped for the work God has laid before her. She will ask herself the most important question: will this or that ensure a Christian upbringing of our children, or will it keep us so too busy for the things of God?" Many a Christian mother has done without in order to enjoy the pleasure of sacrificial love, doing what it takes to ensure that her children are being brought up in the faith, as Timothy's mother and grandmother had done. Can I say this? And I want you to turn your Bibles to 2 Timothy. I want to show you that story. But I want to say this as you go to 2 Timothy, that one of the tricks of the enemy is to get us all focused. And because you have such a great influence, over and over again, these testimonies that you've seen on screen and many others out there, you know that your mother has an influence in your life, in your faith, in your stamina, in your perseverance. And this is what Paul is saying in 2 Timothy. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 3, this is what Paul says to Timothy: because Timothy was assigned a hard task. He was to put in elders in the church, and that is a very, very hard task. And Timothy wants to give up, but this is what Paul says to Timothy in verse number 3 of chapter number 1 of 2 Timothy. He says, "I thank God whom I serve with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I constantly remember you in my prayers night and day, remembering your tears, I long to see you that I may be filled with joy, clearly recalling your sincere faith that first lived in your grandmother, Lois, and then in your mother, Eunice, and that I'm convinced is also in you." Watch this. Paul says, there's three generations, Timothy. Timothy, I know you want to give up, but your grandmother believed, and your mama believed. And Timothy, what your grandmother believed, what your mama believed, that's in you also. See, that's a generational influence. That is a generational, what Paul is saying to Timothy: you can't give up. You got to persevere. Because as the faith that helped your mother, the faith that helped your grandmother is the same faith I am convinced is in you. Mothers, you have this incredible ability to plant a seed in your children that will outlast your life. Your children's children will be blessed because of the seed that you plant of influence in your children. Your seed of faith is influence. See, there's no guarantee that every child is going to come to know the Lord by faith. But the odds are definitely against them if you are not a person of authentic, practical faith. If your children don't see faith working in you, it's very unlikely that they're going to come to faith easy when it comes to the Lord. But when they see faith working in you, then it makes it easier for the Holy Spirit to show them this is the way to go. Now let's see a mother's intercession. What you see in verse number 12 is no less than a prayer. Rahab prays. How can I say this? Because she says, swear to me by the Lord. This is a commitment that God is making. She's appealing to God through these men to say, swear to me by the Lord that you will be kind to me and my family. I want you to see this in real time. I want you to turn in the Bible to Matthew chapter 15. Now, hold on. It's about to get real, real bumpy right now. I want you to know this. I'm going to show you some things in Scripture. In Matthew chapter 15, I want you to see, and we're talking several hundred years later on, Jesus is on the ground. Jesus is speaking. And I want you to see the fruit. I want you to see the fruit of Rahab's faith all the way in the book of Matthew. In Matthew chapter 15, are you there with me, church? Verse number 21, the Bible says this, leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman, hold it, a Canaanite woman. Now that's significant because remember in Joshua chapter 2, they're about to go into Canaan. And Canaan was a wide area, and they were going to conquer Canaan, but they were going to do it methodically. And so they went first to Jericho because Jericho was in the center. And after conquering Jericho, they'll go to what's on the north and what's on the south, and they're going to conquer all of Canaan. And so now the Bible says in Matthew chapter 15, now here comes this Canaanite woman from the same vicinity, verse number 22. And she came to Jesus crying, Lord, Son of who, church? Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly. Now, son of David, that's going to have significance in just a minute. I'm going to decode because Jesus and this woman are talking on code, okay? Watch this, verse 23. And Jesus did not answer a word, so his disciples came to him and urged him, send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. Poor disciples. She said, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is sick. Verse number 24, he answered to her, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. He replied, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Yes, it is, Lord, she says. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Verse number 28, then Jesus said to her, woman, you have great what, church? You have great what? Faith. Now, this is a Canaanite woman. Don't miss this. This is a Canaanite woman that came to him and says, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus says, no. He didn't answer her. Then she came and knelt before him and says, have mercy on me. My daughter is sick. Jesus says, I come to the lost sheep of Israel first. She said, yes, Lord. She said, he says, it's not right to throw the crumbs away, toss them to the dogs. He said, oh, yes, but at least the dogs get the crumbs. And Jesus says to her, verse number 28, woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. And the Bible says her daughter was healed when, church, at that moment. Now, some would look at this and say, wow, Jesus, that's pretty hard. Jesus was being very rude, but they're talking in code to one another. I'm going to reveal this code in just a minute, but I want to make this point. This woman was persistent. This woman, after Jesus ignored her request, came and knelt before him. Even after it seemed that there was an obvious way where Jesus had embarrassed her or somehow offended her, she didn't let that stop her because she wanted her daughter to be healed. And she was not going to stop at anything, even the disciples who thought that they were being cried after, because she wanted her daughter to be healed. Can I tell you something? Nothing can match the power of a mother's prayer. Some of you know you're in church today because mama prayed for you. You know that had it not been for the Lord on your side and your mama on her knees, you don't know where you'd be. Brothers and sisters, intercession of a mother is powerful. It is powerful. So, preacher, decode this message. Before I get there, I want to show you something that our faith, mothers, your faith must lead to an action. And this is what Rahab had. Rahab had faith, and her faith caused her to act on it. And this is why she's highly regarded, not only in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament. I showed you earlier in Hebrews chapter 11. Now I want you to see in James chapter 2, again, Rahab is mentioned, okay? Now we're talking James. We're talking New Testament. We're talking after Jesus has been resurrected and ascended into God. And now they're still recalling the story of Rahab. Why? Because it was a powerful story of faith that led to action. In James chapter 2, verse 23, the Bible says, "And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God." You see then that a man is justified by works and not by faith only. Likewise, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? See, again, Abraham is mentioned, and right with Abraham, Rahab is mentioned. Her great faith. But watch this. "For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is what, church? Dead. You have faith in God. That's why you're here. But that faith must lead to action. What is that action? That you will pray. That you'll do the hard work of living in such a way that your children will see your faith. And you'll be an influence to them. Okay, preacher, let's decode this. In Matthew chapter 15, the woman said, "Jesus, son of who, church? David. Jesus, son of David." And she was a what, church? Canaanite, right? This Canaanite woman came to Jesus and had the audacity to say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." I want you to turn in Matthew, right there in Matthew, and let's decode what's happening here. It seems that Jesus is offending this woman, but he's not. It seems that somehow this woman has lost her way. Why would this Canaanite woman approach Jesus? Why would this Canaanite woman have the audacity to demand that Jesus heal her daughter? She's demanding it. She's pleading with him. She's not going to let him go. I don't care, you call me a dog, you call me a rat, I'm not leaving till my daughter's healed. That's what she's saying. But I want you to know she has a claim here. And I want you to see her claim. Go to Matthew chapter 1. Are you there with me, church? Matthew, are you there with me? Okay, Matthew chapter 1. Let's decode the woman's request. In Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse number 1, the Bible says this: "The historical record of Jesus Christ, the son of who? The son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham fathered Isaac. Isaac fathered Jacob. Jacob fathered Judah and his brothers. Judah fathered Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez fathered Hezron. Hezron fathered Aram. Aram fathered Abinadab. Abinadab fathered Nahshon. Nahshon fathered Solomon. Solomon fathered Boaz by Rahab." Hold it a minute. Rahab? Is this the same Rahab, preacher, that is Joshua chapter 2? Absolutely. Let's keep on reading. Solomon fathered Boaz by Rahab. Boaz fathered Obed by Ruth. Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered who? King David. Hold it now. So this Canaanite woman says to Jesus, "Jesus, son of David." This Canaanite woman says to Jesus, "Hey, Jesus, I know who your great, 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 great grandmama is." Yeah. "That you are the son of David, and that you are the seed of Jesse, and you're the seed of Obed, you're the seed of Boaz, and I know exactly who your great-great-great-great-great-grandmother is, great-great-great-great-great-grandmother is. She is a Canaanite woman by the name of Rahab." And so therefore, she came boldly to Jesus and said, "Hey, Jesus, son of David, one who's just like me, guess what? I need you to heal my son and my daughter." And that's why she was persistent. That's why she had faith. That's why Jesus clearly said, hey, I've come to the lost household of Israel first. But she says, hey, wait a minute. Don't worry about it. You may call me a dog, but don't worry. I'm still in the house. I don't care what you call me. I'm in the house. And I'm a part of you. Look at this. The last point today is this mother's inheritance. I want you to hear this very clearly. When Rahab died, she had no clue that Jesus would be a part of her lineage. When Rahab died, she had no clue that King David would be directly a grandson, great-great-great-grandson of hers. She had no clue. But guess what? Every mother gets an inheritance. One day, when we're all together in heaven, it will be revealed to Rahab that not only did she save three generations, but she saved a whole, she was a part of God's great plan of salvation for the whole earth, every Gentile. And everybody say amen on that. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that? What an unlikely story. What an unlikely story. I mean, we see Rahab as a prostitute. We see Rahab as a liar. We see Rahab as this woman that has a bad past and a horrible future. But no. Her future, because of her faith, has brought her into the ancestry line of Jesus Christ. She gets an inheritance. I know some of you mothers are sitting here today saying, you know what? I am sure my son is a son straight from Satan. Maybe you're sitting here today and you're sure that your daughter came from the devil. But I want you to know something. God can take that wayward seed and use that child for his kingdom, brothers and sisters. And although, watch this, you may not see it, but God is, it is definitely possible with God. Amen, church. See, that's what faith is. That's what faith is. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. And by faith, you can believe that your daughter's son's daughter, son, will be incredible for the things of God. Amen, church. You may not see it in this lifetime, but every mother gets an inheritance. One day, when you're in that sweet place, you have a claim that only you can receive. Think about this. Your mother's mother would probably be surprised that you're in the kingdom of God. But one day, there will be an inheritance. Every mother gets an inheritance. And what the enemy wants us to do is focus on the now and not begin to look forward in the future. And this story has been given to us for every mother to have courage, to pray, to believe that God has a plan, not only for your seed, but for your seed's seed for the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Father, I thank you today that there is an inheritance for every mother. Lord, I thank you today that some mothers present may not see it, but we know you're able. Lord, today, I pray for every mother to know that her faith can influence generations ahead of her. I'm going to ask every mother to stand right now. Every mother figure, because there's spiritual mothering too. And I want you to do something. It may seem odd, but I want you to pray for your children that you'll never meet. I want you to pray for children that you won't see this side of heaven. I want you to pray for generations beyond your days. I want you by faith, to believe that your great, 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 great grandson would do great works for God. I want you by faith to believe that your great, 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 great granddaughter will love your God like you love your God. I want you to intercede for children you won't meet, until heaven. Father, right now, we thank you for Rahab's story. And oh, the joy that's going to flood her soul when she sees. Not only did she save that generation, but because of her great faith, Lord Jesus, she's included in the bloodline of our dear Savior. And Lord, maybe there's some Rahabs in the household today that because of their past, they think, Lord, because, you know, I don't deserve this. I aborted a child. You know that, Lord. And I went through this and I was promiscuous and I did all these things. Lord, I wasn't faithful to you early on, but I want you to know something. If any man, any woman, any mother be in Christ, you are a brand new creation. If God can clean up and rehab Rahab, he can clean up and rehab you. So Lord, right now we are in a seat by faith. We believe that our children's children, children will know that you are the one true living God. And every mother here today, I'm going to be quiet and I want you to sing this song, I Give Myself Away, because it's you that has the power to influence.
I love you, Mom.
And today we want to give ourselves away again to God for your glory, for the story. So every mother, I want you to recommit your mothering, your influence to God right now, singing, I give myself away. Just the mothers, just the mothers. I give myself away, yes. I give myself. Hear the ladies in the house. Come on, ladies out there, sing. Give myself away. Come on, ladies. Let's hear your voice. Let's hear your voice. Lift your voice. I give myself away. Yes, yes. Come on, ladies, sing it. I give myself away. Yes, Lord. Father, today, I thank you today. You hear the cry of your daughters. Lord, the mothers that give themselves away, not only for this generation, but for the generations to come. Use their faith walk to influence generations beyond their imagining. Lord, today, for the mother that is without hope today, I pray that she would have hope to know that her hope, her strength comes from you and you only. For the single mother, may she know that she's not alone, that you are with her. And for the mother who may have a husband and a father in the house, but still seems as if she's doing it by herself, may she know that you are there to strengthen her. And for the ones just having a great relationship, strengthen them as only you can. Father, today, recommitting ourselves to you and to you only. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Can we thank God for these mothers? God bless you. God bless you. I want everybody else to stand. Stand. Everybody else to stand with us right now. I want you to hear this now. Not only is there physical mothering, but there is spiritual mothering as well. You do know that, right? And every seed you sow, every seed that's planted, it will bear harvest. There's inheritance laid up for each one of us. I want you to grab the hand of the person next to you. I want you to look them in the face and tell them to persevere. Tell them to persevere, 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 persevere. Father, today we thank you today that there is an inheritance. On this glorious Mother's Day, We thank you. And Father, today we know that eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard the things that are in store for us on that day. And so we persevere until then. Lord, as we leave, we worship in our giving. Bless the seed and bless the sower. Our prayer counselors are coming down front today. Mothers in particular, we're here to pray for you. Fathers, we're here to pray for you. Sons and daughters, we're here to pray for you. And I pray that out of his glorious riches, he strengthen us with power through his spirit in our inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. I pray we've been rooted, grounded in his love, bear power together with all God's people to grasp how wide, how long, how high, how deep the love of Christ is for us. And to know his love that transcends the ability to comprehend, that we might be filled to the fullness of the measure of God in our lives. And now to our great God, he's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or even imagine. To him be all the glory, all the majesty, the dominion and power forever and ever, we pray. And those who love Jesus said, amen, amen. God bless you. God bless you.